I'd like to talk about one common misconception about the numerical lifting line algorithm. And you may have noticed that Phillips and Snyder published this in the year 2000. Okay, so Phillips and Snyder published this in the year 2000. And Prandtl developed the original lifting line, the infinite series solution in about, it was 1918, I think, was the first publication, and 1921, I believe, was when it was translated into English. So anyway, there's 80 years here between these, and there were other numerical methods for solving a lifting line type algorithm, and different people had presented options for generalizing Prandtl's work for wings with sweep and dihedral and multiple lifting surfaces, you know. So Phillips and Snyder were not the first to take a crack at this. And one of the most common methods is called Weisinger's. So Weisinger's method. And a lot of people say that Weisinger's method is a correct solution for the numerical lifting line algorithm. And I just want to point out the differences between Weisinger's method and Phillips and Snyder's method here, because I think it's pretty important to understand. So let's take a wing here. We'll just draw it with sweep for fun. And so we've got this series of horseshoe vortices. Okay, so Weisinger set up his algorithm the same way, where he put a series of horseshoe vortices across the swing, and what he did to evaluate the strength of gamma for each of these vortices is he put a control point at the 3/4 chord location. And he said that at that location, the velocity, the total velocity at that location dotted with n, so we'll say v sub I, but that v sub I now refers to the v, the velocity there at the 3/4 chord location, dotted with n sub I, that's the normal vector off of the top of, out of the planform there of the wing, had to be equal to zero. So essentially what he's saying is the velocity at this location, at the 3/4 chord, has to be tangent to the planform, okay, or to the chord line, really, or you can also use the camber line, okay? So anyway, he's putting the, that's what he's using for his closing boundary condition, is that v dot n at each of these locations has to be equal to zero. And so then that gives him n equations, because he's got n boundary conditions along here, n unknowns of gamma, and now you can solve, that gives you a full system of equations where you can solve for the strength of gammas that satisfy that. Now, that's not necessarily incorrect, but there are also some limitations to Weisinger's method. One of those is that actually this boundary condition is derived from flat plate theory, okay? So you can show that the correct vortex strength for a flat plate, if we were to put just a flat plate here, the correct vortex strength at the quarter chord that gives you the right amount of lift for this plate at some angle of attack below stall is equal to the correct amount of vorticity makes the normal velocity at the 3/4 chord go to zero. Okay, you can prove that through flat plate theory. I've also heard that that is true more generally if you apply it to the camber line instead of the chord line. Maybe I should be drawing the side view of this. So here's our flat plate. We've got our quarter chord gamma, and then we've got our 3/4 chord location with our normal like that. And so what we're saying is that v dot n equals zero, so that the velocity at that location has to be parallel to the chord line. I've heard, though, that that is also true, and I haven't proven this, but I've heard that that's also true if you have a camber line that is parabolically shaped and you apply the vorticity again at the quarter chord, and then take into account the angle You know, so we've got some angle there due to the camber line, and put your normal to the camber line instead. Anyway, this is what he used to close his solution. Now, that's very different than what Prandtl did. Prandtl said, I'm going to relate the vorticity or the lift due to vorticity here to the lift that we would get from two-dimensional airfoil theory. And that closes the solution, okay? So we've got lift from in 3Ds, the vortex lifting law, and then in 2D, we have lift as a function of angle of attack from thin airfoil theory, or from airfoil theory in general. And so we can equate those two, and that's enough information to close this system to get the value for gamma at every location. And that is the same approach that Phillips and Snyder took. So they revisited what Prandtl had done, made his same approximation. And so Phillips and Snyder's development really is a more accurate lifting line solution, a true numerical lifting line algorithm, okay? Weisinger's method is actually more similar to what we call the vortex lattice method. So here, the vortex lattice method is also a very common potential flow method. And basically what you do there is you grid this you grid your wing up spanwise and chordwise, and you place a horseshoe vortex along for each of these sections, but you actually place multiple horseshoe vortices in the chordwise direction. So there would be horseshoe vortices that look like that, and then you'd have another horseshoe vortex going right there. So you'd have horseshoe vortices there, and we could keep going with more colors here, but basically you put multiple horseshoe vortices, not only in the spanwise direction like we do in these other methods, but also in the chordwise direction. And so, you know, that's beneficial because now you can capture camber, you know, in some sense you can capture camber, and then what they do basically is solve V dot N again. So V dot N, at basically at the center of each of these panels, we say V dot N equals zero. Now you can stagger these panels and say that you're actually going to put them on the, so if this is your panel, you can put the horseshoe vortex on the quarter chord line of that panel, and then apply the V dot N at the three quarter chord location on that panel. And that, I think, is actually what they technically claim that they're doing, but I'm fairly certain that's about, I think the math works out to be the same as just doing it in the center of each panel. Anyway, that doesn't really matter. The point that I'm making here is that Weisinger's method is really the vortex lattice method with a single chordwise vortex, you know, so you only have a single vortex at each spanwise location instead of multiple horseshoe vortices. So Weisinger's method and the vortex lattice method are very closely related. But Phillips and Snyder's is significantly different, mostly because they use a completely different set of boundary conditions to close the problem, okay? And their boundary conditions really are the same boundary conditions that Prandtl used 100 years ago. So I just wanted to point that out. You know, in textbooks, you'll find these different methods. You know, a method like this, like Weisinger's method, is often called a lifting line method. And, you know, it can be called a lifting line method because it places all of the lift along what's called the lifting line. So that's just fine. But the misconception comes in believing that what Weisinger did was equivalent to what Prandtl suggested doing for just a straight wing. And that's not true. Weisinger took a different method to close his system of equations, and Phillips and Snyder took a method that is more a direct analog to what Prandtl had done.